Welcome, everyone. If you came here to hear from Dr. Don Murphy about China's rise in the global South, you're in the right Zoom room. This event is organized and hosted by the Africa-China Initiative, or ACI. ACI is a relatively new initiative here at the Walsh School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University. Institutionally, we are hosted by the African and Asian Studies programs and funded by the Henry Luce Foundation. This event is co-sponsored by Georgetown's Initiative for U.S.-China Dialogue on Global Issues and the Center for Contemporary Arab Studies. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Yoonjung Park, and I'm the Program Director of ACI. I also teach in African Studies here, and I serve as Executive Director of the Chinese in Africa, Africans in China Research Network. I'm so pleased to introduce our main speaker, Dr. Don Murphy. Dr. Murphy is an associate professor of national security strategy at the U.S. National War College, specializing in Chinese foreign policy and domestic politics, U.S.-China relations, and international relations. Her research analyzes China's interests and behavior as a rising global power towards the existing international order. Today, she will speak to us from her new book, China's Rise in the Global South, the Middle East, Africa, and Beijing's Alternative World Order. In it, she analyzes China's foreign policy approach towards the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa regionally, and through detailed case studies of the China Arab States Cooperation Forum, the Forum on China-Africa Cooperation, the China-Middle East Issues Special Envoy, and other such initiatives. Also with us today as discussants are Evan Medeiros and Obert Hudsey. Dr. Hudsey is a lecturer in politics at the University of Liverpool in the UK. His research focuses on the politics of human rights and development and non-Western emerging powers in global governance with empirical expertise in China and Africa. He is the author of the book, The End of China's Non-Intervention Policy in Africa. Dr. Hudsey is also the new chair of the executive board of the Chinese in Africa, Africans in China Research Network. Dr. Medeiros is the Penner Family Chair in Asian Studies in the School of Foreign Service and the Kling Family Distinguished Fellow in U.S.-China Studies. His research and teaching focuses on international politics of East Asia, U.S.-China relations, and China's foreign and national security policies. He's published several books and articles and regularly provides advice to global corporations and commentary to the international media. He previously served for 6 years on the staff of the National Security Council as Director for China, Taiwan, and Mongolia, and then as Special Assistant to President Obama and Senior Director for Asia. Before I hand over to Dr. Murphy, just a brief rundown of the program. Our events usually last about 90 minutes. Dr. Murphy will speak for about 30. She'll be followed by Dr. Medeiros and Dr. Hudsey, who will each have about 10 to 12 minutes to respond to Dr. Murphy's book talk. We will then hopefully have enough time for at least two rounds of questions. Please type your questions into the Q&A box below on the Zoom and not in the chat. I will then read a selection of these to our speakers for their responses. Please indicate to whom your question is addressed and please be as brief as possible. Finally, in case we lose some of you before the very end of the program, I wanted to say thank you to my colleagues without whom this event could not have taken place. Professor Laura Smith and Martha Manzano of African Studies, Professor Yuki Tajima, Annalise Burke and Robert Lyons of Asian Studies, Susan Douglas at the Center for Contemporary Asian Studies, and Dr. Tom Banchoff, Toya Wulong and Eleanor Albert of the U.S.-China Dialogue. And of course, the Henry Luce Foundation for their generous support. With that, let me hand over to Don. Thank you, Don, again, for being with us.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I appreciate it. I should start with my disclaimer that today the views I express are my own and they do not represent the National War College, Department of Defense, or the US government. The overall argument of the book is that although China does not seek to change the international distribution of territory in the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa, as its power grows, it increasingly competes with the US, builds spheres of influence in these regions, and challenges the rules of the international system by constructing an alternative international order to facilitate interactions. China does not yet seek to replace the existing international order. But if the current order unravels or excludes China, this alternative order could serve as the foundation of China's economic, political, and military relations with the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa, as well as with the rest of the developing world. The book answers the following questions. What are China's interests in the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa? Is China competing or cooperating with the US in these regions? Is China's behavior converging or diverging with the liberal international order? Is China building an alternative international order? And if yes, what are the characteristics of that order? How does China portray itself as a great power in these regions? And ultimately, what does this behavior in these regions indicate about China's rise globally? So before I really dive into the talk, I want to give a few definitions. When I talk about the Middle East, I'm referring to the broader Middle East, including the League of Arab States with North Africa, as well as Iran, Israel, and Turkey. And when I talk about sub-Saharan Africa, I'm talking about the rest of the continent minus North Africa. I'm not using the terms revisionist or status quo in my work, but for each foreign policy tool examined, I categorize foreign policy behavior as either competitive or cooperative with the US and convergent or divergent with the liberal order. And this morning, I won't get into a detailed description of what the liberal international order is, but I would say for each specific foreign policy tool examined, there are different elements of that order, and I would be happy in Q&A to discuss that more. The overall findings of the book are that as China's power grows, it's competing in the functional areas of economics and politics, and its behavior often, but not always, diverges from the liberal international order. In contrast, in the security realm, China is cooperating, and its behavior is mostly converging with the liberal order. Also, as China's perception of threat from the US increases, its competitive and norm-divergent behavior is amplified. So now I want to briefly discuss what China's interests are in these regions. Some of the foreign policy tools that I examine in the book with a particular emphasis on cooperation forums and special envoys. And then I'll say a few words about how China portrays itself in these regions. And finally, some conclusions based on this more broadly about China's behavior. So China's interests in the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa. First, it wants to acquire resources and markets to fuel China's own economic growth. And I do think it's really important, you know, obviously there's a lot of emphasis on resource needs, but I would say that desire for markets for goods and services in this region is just as important to China as acquiring natural resources. China's next interest is fostering support for itself in the international system during an era of emerging multipolarity or bipolarity. And we could discuss that in the Q&A, but regardless of the characteristics of that system, China wants support from the 53 countries on the continent of Africa that recognize it and the countries in the Middle East, in the United Nations, in the World Trade Organization, in the G20, in, you know, many different configurations. But these states are very important to them in those forums. Next, China wants to ensure its own domestic stability. And in particular, Xinjiang is in this issue. So China seeks, especially with Arab states and with Muslim majority states, to have relative silence from these states regarding its behavior in Xinjiang. And this will come up a few times in the presentation. China's next interest is advocating for developing country causes. And this ties back to a very long history going into the Mao era even of China seeing itself as the leader of the third world, of the developing world, of the global South, and seeing itself as an advocate for states within these regions more broadly. China also wants to safeguard its citizens and businesses abroad. This has been a growing concern, especially over the last 10 years. If you think about Libya in 2011, when China had to evacuate out 35,000 of its citizens, it also had similar situations in Yemen and Syria and in other conflict scenarios. Chinese citizens increasingly have been the target of terrorist activities and kidnapping and other threats to their safety. So this is increasingly an interest. And finally, China is wanting to protect its own territorial integrity and sovereignty from the US by gaining support from these countries. So what I mean by this is before 2010, I think arguably China looked at regions, whether it was the Middle East or sub-Saharan Africa or Asia, Latin America, looked at them in isolation in certain ways in their relations. But increasingly, it's seeking support from countries in the Middle East and Africa for its stance on the South China Sea, for its behavior in relation to Hong Kong. And although having recognition of the PRC versus Taiwan has been an important element of Chinese foreign policy for many decades, it also increasingly seeks the support of these states to continue to advocate for it on behalf of that issue. So now I'm gonna talk about the foreign policy tools that I examine in the book. The first one that I look at is cooperation forums. So I look at the Forum on China-Africa Cooperation, which has 53 states. So that's every state on the continent of Africa minus Eswatini that continues to recognize Taiwan. And that forum meets every 3 years. Its last meeting was in 2021 during COVID. Another cooperation forum I examine is the China-Arab States Cooperation Forum. Established in 2004. This includes all of the League of Arab States. So it also includes North Africa, both of these forums do. And it meets every 2 years. Its last meeting was in December this year that was held in Saudi Arabia. And I would note that the last meeting of this forum was held at the summit level. Previously, all of the meetings had been at the ministerial level. So these two cooperation forums are the primary multilateral coordination mechanisms that China uses with the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa. And they cover a broad range of issues in the economic, political, security, foreign aid, et cetera realm. I would note for you, I'm not going to discuss this in depth, but there are many other types of cooperation that are encompassed in these forums, in the environment and education and health and a wide range of other issues. The political norms underlying these cooperation forums are the five principles of peaceful coexistence. So the way to think about that is a very strict interpretation of Westphalian sovereignty. Another important norm is South-South cooperation, as well as in the China-Arab States Cooperation Forum, there is an aspect of China demonstrating support for the Palestinians. And I should note here that for those of you that look at the Mao era, obviously, back during the Mao era, China was providing material support to various Palestinian groups. Since 1992, China has recognized Israel and has strong relations with both Arab states and Israel and other countries in the region. But Arab states continue to want China to demonstrate support for the Palestinians in various ways. So this is an important element of those forums. And as I mentioned earlier, the Arab states being relatively silent about China's behavior in Xinjiang is also a political dynamic. On the economic front, the norms that underlie these forums are heavy state involvement in trade, investment, infrastructure, in contrast with the liberal order that emphasizes free markets and limited state intervention. Another element under these cooperation forums is foreign aid. I'm assuming many of you are familiar with China's foreign aid approach in these regions, but essentially, it does not have political conditionality other than recognizing the PRC, but there is a great deal of economic conditionality requiring Chinese firms to be used in various foreign aid contracts. On the security front, that's a limited part of these forums, but when it is emphasized as an issue, there is a desire to have peacekeeping operations, nuclear-free zones in these regions, increased counterterrorism cooperation. So those are the types of issues that are covered. I do want to say a few words about these forums in contrast with the Shanghai Cooperation Organization that many of you may already be familiar with. The SCO is a cooperation forum also that was established in 2001 that includes China, Russia, as well as Central Asian states, and India and Pakistan. Over time, it has been expanding to also include Middle Eastern countries. So in 2022, Iran became a formal member, and Turkey has started the process of becoming a full-fledged member. In 2022, you also had a number of states in the region become dialogue partners. Those were Saudi, Egypt, and Qatar. And in 2022, Bahrain, Kuwait, and the United Arab Emirates have started the process of becoming dialogue partners. So increasingly, this forum is encompassing more and more of the Middle East. And as many of you are aware, in September this last year was the last meeting of that forum. It meets every year as opposed to every 2 or 3 years. And it originally was formed on security issues, but has become over time more involved in the economic and political realm. The next foreign policy tool I want to highlight for you are China's special envoys. The purpose of these envoys are for China to contribute to peace and security in these regions and address what it sees as hotspots. There are four that it has established over time in the Middle East and Africa. So the first was established in 2002, and it is the Special Envoy for Middle East Issues. Since its beginning, it is focused on the Middle East peace process and attempting to contribute to the Palestinian-Israeli and broader Arab-Israeli conflict. I won't say a lot about that. I'm assuming the audience is fairly familiar with that issue, but in Q&A, if you're interested, we can talk more about the details regarding its involvement. But that was the purpose from the beginning. The next special envoy that it established was the Special Envoy for Africa Issues in 2007. Originally, this envoy was meant to contribute to resolution of Darfur and contributing to that issue, but increasingly over time, it's changed its focus, where in the early 2010s, it was working quite strongly in dealing with South Sudan issues after South Sudan separated from Sudan more broadly. And all of these special envoys include many other elements of China's interaction with these regions, but the Africa one has focused on those two issues in particular. The next special envoy that China established was for Syria in 2016. And I am going to say a few more words about that because I assume the audience may not be as familiar with why China wanted to be involved in this particular issue. So China was concerned that the Syrian civil war could spill over into the broader Middle East and endanger the stability and China's access to resources more broadly. It wanted to demonstrate it was a responsible power. And the reason I frame it in this way is if you think back to 2012, when you had the double vetoes between China and Russia on the UN Security Council in relation to Syria, there was quite a bit of concern from Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, and a number of Arab countries about the stance China was taking. So establishing the special envoy was an opportunity for China to demonstrate that it was interested in resolution of the conflict. It just didn't want to use UN Security Council resolutions as a way to contribute to that. Another driver of establishing the special envoy is that the Turkestan Islamic Party in Syria, which is an insurgency group, part of that civil war, China is concerned about material support from that group coming into Xinjiang and supporting Uyghurs. Another interest of China is contributing to humanitarian assistance and in the longer term reconstruction of the country. And I should note that this special envoy has participated in many different mechanisms that have sought to resolve the conflict, whether that was the Geneva process, Astana, Vienna, et cetera. And finally, this isn't talked about in the book because it occurred after the book came out, but in early 2022, China established a special envoy for the Horn of Africa. So that one has just started. Next, I want to say a few brief words about other foreign policy tools that China has used in the economic, political, and security realm. So for economics, I think many of you are aware of Chinese state support for its companies, and that in these regions in particular, you have a number of state-owned enterprises because of the sectors that are involved, as well as I mentioned earlier, foreign aid. But one thing you may not be as familiar with is that China's been using a number of other foreign policy tools in the economic realm. One is special economic zones. And what this is if you think about China's own economic development using this model, what they're trying to do in these countries is they provide the seed money for an industrial zone. The purpose of that zone is to attract small and medium-sized Chinese companies to establish operations there. And that in the longer term, you would have spillover effects into the broader economy with skills being gained, as well as opportunities for these Chinese businesses. And those special economic zones have been established in Algeria, Djibouti, Egypt, Ethiopia, Kenya, Mauritius, Nigeria, Oman, and Zambia. So in a number of countries. Another economic foreign policy tool that China utilizes is free trade agreements. So it has already signed one with Mauritius. It is in negotiations with the Gulf Cooperation Council. Those negotiations have been in process since 2004. During Q&A, I'd be happy to talk about some of the roadblocks to that, but they have been actively pursuing that with the Gulf Cooperation Council, which is the Arab Gulf states. They're also pursuing a free trade agreement with Israel and Palestine. So this is another example of them attempting to show they're a balanced actor between those two entities. China has also expressed interest in pursuing a free trade agreement with the African Continental Free Trade Area, which encompasses the entire continent of Africa. Another economic tool that China uses is called agricultural demonstration centers. These, I'm not going to list off all the countries. There's many different countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, where these have been set up. And essentially, this is a center that's focused on a particular crop or other agricultural product. So it could be corn or soy, rice, fisheries, et cetera. China helps set up the center, which the idea is to create capability to build capacity in the country around that particular crop, but also to provide opportunities for Chinese agribusinesses, particularly at the provincial level, to establish market shares in these various countries. Now, switching gears to the political side, I do want to highlight two aspects of political behavior. So one is in UN Security Council voting. So one thing I look at is the difference in votes between the US and China on the UN Security Council in the post-Cold War era. And in these regions, there's really only two areas where you have different votes. One is around sovereignty, and this ties in with a very longstanding Chinese stance of concerns about sanctions and other violations of sovereignty. The other issue that you have a difference of votes on is regarding the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. And it really depends on what the resolution is, whether China's voting yes and the US no, or vice versa, but you do see that divergence. Another foreign policy tool that is examined are strategic partnerships. And I do want to note these strategic partnerships, they aren't alliances, they aren't defense treaties, they aren't formal in that way. But what they are is an expression that China and the country that they establish it with want to have a robust economic and political and potentially security aspects to their relationship. What I want to note for you is that in the Middle East, China has established strategic partnerships with every major country minus Israel. So they have them with Iran and Saudi and UAE and Turkey and Qatar and the Emirates, Egypt, et cetera. In sub-Saharan Africa, they have established them with all of the major anchor countries and an increasing number of countries throughout the region. I would note for you that since 2015, you have had an uptick in these. So that could be associated with Belt and Road. It also could be that it's a tool that Xi Jinping was wanting to use in various ways. So that's strategic partnerships. In the military realm, I would highlight a few aspects of China's behavior. And these are the predominant military activities China has engaged in the timeframe that I examine. So one is United Nations peacekeeping operations. They've engaged in these since 1992, but over time, increasingly, China has been involved in many different missions in the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa. Another behavior is conventional arms sales. When you look in aggregate over these regions over time, really the only time period that you see a real uptick in conventional arms sales was during the 1980s, when China was selling weapons to both Iran and Iraq in that war. Otherwise, the numbers have remained quite low. Another aspect of China's military behavior has been its involvement in anti-piracy activities off the Gulf of Aden since 2008 in a multilateral fashion. And finally, China did establish a base in Djibouti in 2017. And as many of you are, I'm sure, are aware, that before this base was established, China had technically a no overseas basing policy that Djibouti was its first declared overseas base. Of course, China's behavior in the South China Sea with militarization of various features, some of those have very base-like qualities, but this was its first declared base. And I won't go into a lot of detail now, but happy to talk in Q&A, but some of the drivers of establishing this base were being able to support the evacuation of Chinese citizens in situations like Libya, wanting to further contribute to anti-piracy, wanting to be able to have the ability in the future to protect the sea lanes of communication that go through that area, and broader economic interests in Africa, in that particular part of Africa. Today, I'm not saying a lot about Belt and Road, but what I would note for you is that the way that I conceptualize Belt and Road in my own work is that when it was first established, obviously the initial elements of it as far as a land belt and a maritime road in 2013, and then when it was officially announced as Belt and Road in 2015, the original geographic scope included Africa, Asia, and Europe. And from a Chinese conceptualization, the Middle East is part of Asia and Africa. So it encompasses regions from the beginning. I see it very much as an initiative that encompasses all of these regions, right? Not necessarily one country or another, and that it's focused on various types of connectivity more broadly, which, as you all know, increasingly, there's not just a focus on infrastructure, but various types of health cooperation, space cooperation, digital cooperation, green cooperation, et cetera. And all of the foreign policy tools that I've discussed in my presentation today fall under Belt and Road, either formally or informally, from a conceptualization, but also the way that it's portrayed in official documents. So what I want to say next is to give you an idea on the mapping as far as competition and cooperation, convergence and divergence. I don't have time today to go into each foreign policy tool, but as I said earlier in the presentation, when you look at all of these foreign policies that I just described, you have a real difference by functional area. That in general, the economic and political and foreign aid elements are competitive with the US, some converge with the liberal order, but most of them diverge. And when I say some converge, some examples of that would be the free trade agreements that China is pursuing, for example. Then on the security front, as I discussed earlier, China's behavior's mostly been cooperative and it's converged with the liberal order. So participating in UN peacekeeping or supporting UN involvement in negotiations, various other multilateral mechanisms, it very much squarely falls in support of the liberal international order. I next want to say a few words about how China portrays itself as a great power in these regions using these tools. So it portrays itself as a defender of sovereignty, a champion of development and South-South cooperation, a promoter of connectivity, an advocate for multilateral institutions. It characterizes itself as a balanced actor that has positive relations with every country in the Middle East, as well as every country in Africa, minus Eswatini, that continues to recognize Taiwan. And it often emphasizes its lack of a colonial history in these regions, especially in comparison with Western powers. So in conclusion, I've tried to give you a feel for what China's interests are in these regions, the foreign policy tools that it uses to pursue those interests, and how it portrays itself as a great power. So I want to say a few words now about what the findings of this book indicate potentially about China's rise globally. So first, China in these regions is not attempting to maximize its power, but it's also not entirely socializing into the liberal international order. and its behavior varies across functional areas in the ways that I've already described. China is also building significant multilateral mechanisms in these regions, especially cooperation forums. And if you look outside of these regions to other parts of the world in the global south that are outside of China's territorial perimeter, its behavior is very similar. So it's established cooperation forums with Latin American states, with Central European states, with Portuguese-speaking states, et cetera, right? So, and these other foreign policy tools I described, free trade agreements, et cetera, they're pursuing more globally. So I think it gives you an idea of in the global south, outside of their territorial perimeter, the way in which China is behaving as a great power. So I just want to say thank you now. I very much look forward to Evan and Obert's comments. Thank you.
Dawn, thank you so much for that. I'm going to go first to Evan.
Well, thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Don, congratulations. It's a fantastic book. I haven't quite finished reading it yet, but the parts of it that I've read are incredibly impressive. I highly recommend this to everybody joining us today. Not only is China's relationship with the developing world a very, very important issue in the study of Chinese foreign policy, it's absolutely one of the cutting edge issues. It's also increasingly important to questions of broader global order, given the new era that we're in. And one of the great strengths of Dawn's book is the comparative nature of it. Of course, she compares the Middle East and Africa. That's obvious and very, very well done. But she also compares functional areas, the different tools, economic tools, political tools, military tools, et cetera. So you sort of have both a regional and a functional comparison, which analytically is a very, very powerful approach because it reveals all sorts of interesting insights about what China's doing and how effective it is. So Dawn, congratulations. It's a really, really wonderful piece of work and it's perfectly timed. As a discussant, I want to sort of raise some questions, and none of these questions are criticisms or critiques or really anything like that. It's for me, it's much more about, trying to better understand the nature of China's interactions with the developing world. So the first point I want to make, and it's very much a question for Dawn, is that the world we inhabit now, international politics has changed a lot in the last year or 2 years. And knowing the cycles for books, Dawn undoubtedly wrote this book, many years before the Russian invasion of Ukraine, the 20th Party Congress, right? The intensification of the US-China strategic competition, and then broader trends in international affairs, like the trend toward deglobalization or the economic fragmentation. And all of these events, Ukraine, the 20th Party Congress, deglobalization, US-China strategic competition, all of these are going to influence, already are influencing China's relationship with the developing world. And so I'd love to hear from Dawn about how she thinks these events are affecting China's relationship with the developing world. How is it evolving? I would say at sort of first glance, a sort of hot take would be that the developing world has just become a lot more important to China, right? And frankly, if you read what Xi Jinping has been saying in the past 12 months, including most recently at events like in 2022, China hosted the BRICS summit, you have China, Xi Jinping really leaning into the importance of the developing world, which I think further validates Dawn's very good argument that the Chinese do look at the developing world as a sphere of influence of sort and a key part of global order, or I should say, a key part of international affairs that will help China to balance US power, or at least that's how the Chinese are looking at the developing world. But I'd love to hear from Dawn a little bit about you know, since she completed the book, which was undoubtedly, you know, 12 to 18 months ago, big things have happened in China and US China, and of course in global affairs, and how she thinks that's affecting China's relationship with the developing world. Secondly, a question that naturally flows from Don's excellent presentation is, how has China done achieving its interest on? Would love to hear your thoughts on that. So it's very clear that China is both present and active in the Middle East and Africa. And the book does a great job of enumerating the arrows in the quiver. But the question is, have the Chinese really been able to achieve all the economic, political, security interests? And in particular, are there areas, Dawn, where the Chinese have applied a lot of tools, these forums, these envoys, all sorts of stuff, but they actually haven't gotten as much as they wanted, right? I mean, a question that often comes up in China studies is the gap between presence and influence, right? I mean, the Chinese can convene meetings, they can send envoys, but if they're not actually doing very much, right? Then, in other words, if the envoys aren't doing very much, and I raise this in the context of the Middle East, when I was at RAND, right before I left RAND in the late 2000s, in 2009, I published this book, China's International Behavior. And what I found was, in terms of the Middle East back then, it's obviously different now, but the Chinese were sort of becoming more active. They had, I think, their first envoy. But on the big questions that Middle Eastern states cared about, so questions like Middle East peace, right? The Israel-Palestine issue, on big issues like the Iranian nuclear issue, right? The Chinese were basically, oh, and Syria. The Chinese were just basically, they weren't silent, but they just, you know, they didn't really contribute much, right? So they had envoys and they did things, but, you know, it wasn't really translating into anybody seeing China as more than an economic actor. Now, of course, you know, fast forward, we're about 15 years from the late 2000s, and we're in an era where obviously Middle Eastern countries are pretty disenfranchised and frustrated with the United States, and they're looking for alternatives. So, you know, the question is it Chinese deft diplomacy that has allowed them to grow their influence, right? Is it the application of all the arrows in their quiver? Or is it changes in regional perceptions and, frankly, challenges, problems in American foreign policy that has created an opening for China? So how has China done in achieving its interests, and how much of what it has achieved is a result of China versus the region changing? Third question for you, Dawn, is about military diplomacy, because your section on military diplomacy is excellent. It talks about China's contribution to PKOs, arms sales. But I feel like there may be a bit more there. And, you know, this certainly could be, simply a function of book production cycles. But when I look at the Middle East, I look at China establishing a pretty robust defense security cooperation relationship with both the Saudis and the Emiratis. So we're talking about with the Saudis, UAVs, missiles, satellites. I mean, China looks like it's emerging as a very substantial security partner to the Saudis. When it comes to the Emiratis, similarly UAVs, but also there's been a lot of discussion about, you know, China establishing a naval base with the UAE. So sort of, can you get us up to speed from when the book was published about in the Middle East in particular, but welcome your insights on Africa as well. Is China, now that the Chinese military, the PLA, is, bigger, more sophisticated, clearly they have a more advanced force structure. So they're basically their product offering when it comes to arms sales and security cooperation has the potential to be a lot more substantial. So are you seeing that? Are you seeing the sort of the military security assistance arrow in the quiver in the Middle East and Africa? Is it becoming, more substantial? Fourth question relates specifically to the Middle East and especially Saudi Arabia, right? And In late 2022, Xi Jinping took this really interesting trip to Saudi Arabia. And just sort of tell us a little bit about what that was about. And it looked to me like it was probably a leading indicator of where China's diplomacy toward the Middle East is going. And in particular, I think part of it was Saudi Arabia looking for alternatives, or at least to diversify their great power relationships as tensions emerge in the U.S.-Saudi relationship. But what was most interesting to me about the Saudi relationship was not just the energy component, which we know about and that's important, but it looked like the Chinese and the Saudis signed a whole variety of MOUs on issues that are about Saudi Arabia building a non-oil dependent economy, a lot more than that. So is the Chinese product offering to the Middle East, and is there a greater convergence between sort of what Middle Eastern countries want from China and what China is willing to supply, and in particular helping Saudi Arabia, modernize to build an economy that is not fully oil dependent. So that, I don't know how closely you followed Xi's trip, but that seemed like a particularly important trip, and a trip that might tell us more about China Middle East relations than just sort of one bilateral meeting. Fourth question is about Africa and the Middle East, and your view on whether or not those two regions really do see China as a leader of the developing world. Right, this is has long been part of China's self-identity. Right, we are the largest developing country, we're the leader of the developing world, and we want to sort of work with you much more closely. And basically, does that resonate? Right, does that message work? Because from the Chinese perspective, they're the largest developing country. Right, in the United States, we say, is China really a developing country anymore? Second largest economy in the world. Right, it may soon become a upper income economy, depending on how their economy evolves. So how much traction is China really getting with this leader of the developing world? Or is it really just countries in the Middle East and Africa want to deal with China because it's a large economy, it wants to buy their resources, it wants to invest in them, it's willing to help them through infrastructure investment and other types of investment to develop their market, which of course China can then sell into. So I'd be curious to see, get your assessment of the connectivity between how those regions see China and China's effort to promote itself. And then I guess the last question is something that you touched on in the book, but you didn't get too much time to address in your presentation, was about comparing China's diplomacy to the Middle East and Africa. What do you see as the major similarities? What do you see as the major differences? When you listed the various Chinese interests toward both regions, it'd be curious to sort of see a breakdown about what are Chinese priorities in protecting their interests in the Middle East versus Africa, and sort of how are they doing, right? I mean, are these, did you find any particular insights from comparing these regions, or do you think it would make sense to compare other regions, which is sort of my final point, which is just to get you to speculate, Don, about Latin America, right? Because that's the one region that's not in here. And I know that you've looked at this, and I'd be curious to just get you to sort of riff a little while about what you think China's trying to do in Latin America, how similar it is to the Middle East and Africa, right? Traditionally, we don't think of China as having a robust security cooperation agenda in Latin America. Is that changing? And just, just a little bit of speculation, trying to draw on the lessons of Middle East and Africa. But again, Don, congratulations, wonderful piece of work, really well-timed. I hope that you continue to stay on this wicket, because China's relationship with the developing world, to me, is one of the most important dimensions of Chinese foreign policy in this new post-Cold War era that I talked about at the beginning. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Evan, thanks so much. Don, before you even try to tackle all of Evan's questions, let's go to Overt Hutzi.
Thank you very much. And thank you very much, Don, for this wonderful book. I think it's a great book. When it was released, it was on my reading list, and it's great that I was invited to be a discussant. So I read it much faster than I could have. But it's a wonderful book, timely as well, as Ivania said. And it touches on two regions that I think are very important, particularly with the things that have happened over the past maybe 5 years or so. The Middle East and Africa have become very important actors in global issues. So like Ivan has said, I have a few questions that I think you touched on in your book, but I think you can explain them a little bit further for the benefit of those who haven't read it. So, and I'll mostly focus on Africa because that's what I know a little bit more about. So one of the points that you raise in the book is that China is able to, or China is using the Middle East and using Africa to achieve its foreign policy objectives, but also to extend its influence in world politics. And I think that's a great point. But the question is, do you think that through Africa, China is able to achieve or to increase its influence in world politics and achieve its foreign policy objectives? Achieving its foreign policy objectives, as you put rightly well in your book, is quite easy for China to do in Africa, right? It can test its policies. It has an audience that is ready to listen to them, disgruntled by the West, particularly the United States. So it has a listening ear in many African countries. But whether it is able to use its relations with African countries to influence world politics, I think that's where the challenge is. And I'd really love to hear your thoughts on that, because one of the things that have continuously come up, and this has been the story of Africa, is how much influence does it have? And that influence is limited by the lack of economic development in many African countries, the dependence on foreign aid and assistance from the West by African countries, and generally an environment that is quite unstable in many ways, an environment where, if you look, for instance, in terms of education, only 9% of Africans end up going into tertiary education. And therefore, even when people talk about this population dynamic in Africa, the young population, it's poorly skilled to meet the demands of the modern world. And if China then is concentrating on this region and hoping that it will be a springboard for it to exercise influence, how useful would that be? And I think Ivan pointed it quite well when you talked about the difference between the presence and influence. So in Africa, it is present, but is it influential? Is it achieving what it hopes to achieve? And linked to that point is something that I thought was quite interesting, which you mentioned in your book, that China is building, China's engagement with sub-Saharan Africa is based on all, it's based on its emphasis on South-South cooperation, and the second thing, on development initiatives. So if you look at infrastructure development, China has done a massive job, but there are problems with that even, right? Even in countries like Kenya, where it has done well, but questions are now being raised about the suitability of that infrastructure, the cost of that infrastructure, and what it means for ordinary people in many African countries. So this emphasis on South-South cooperation, over the past years, it was very easy for China to say, we are equal partners, win-win cooperation, we are engaging, we have a common enemy in some sense. We're fighting against the imperial West and neocolonialism and all that language. It really sold quite well. for the older generation of African leaders. But now there's an emergence of a new generation of African leaders who question this South-South cooperation, who question whether China is treating African countries as an equal. Is Africa an equal partner in China-Africa relations? And I think those questions are beginning to come up. And the debt trap, even though it wasn't really like it exaggerated the case, but it really had massive influence in the minds of ordinary Africans who looked at China and said, we're being trapped. So I'll give you an example. In Zimbabwe, the Chinese government was building a new parliament. And even though the Chinese embassy in Zimbabwe emphasized on many occasions that this is a donation to the Zimbabwean government, we are not getting anything out of it, people still pushed back and said, what is China getting out of this? We're being duped in some way. There's no free gift. So this idea that China is a benevolent power is actually being questioned in many African countries. But the issue then, what it basically means is if China is using sub-Saharan Africa and the Middle East as a springboard to influence world politics, it's a shaky ground that it is standing on. Shaky ground in the sense that the influence that China has in African countries can only go as far as China is able to provide financing for infrastructure, is able to build palaces, is able to build all this infrastructure that African countries are not necessarily paying for in some way. When China runs out of money, when China starts putting stringent conditions on loans that it's giving to African countries, we can actually see African countries drawing back from China. Angola is a very good example, right? It was modeled as this is the ultimate example of what China-Africa engagement can look like. But Angola today is distancing itself from China and going back to the West. Why is that happening, right? And Zambia is a good example as well. The change of leadership brought a change of focus, right? To some extent, that really shows that the ground on which China is standing on is a bit shaky. Therefore, its alternative world order, if it has won, is shaky in some way. It is not going to stand the test of time. It depends on the willingness of China to continue buying that favor from African countries. So in my thinking, I would perhaps caution this idea that China has an alternative model or alternative international order that can easily take off. And part of it is not, you know, all the things that I've said about African countries' attitude towards China, but also the way that China projects itself to the developing world. The first thing is that China is not sure. It continues to play around this idea. Do we have a model? Do we not have a model? Do we want an alternative order or do we not want an alternative order? Right? It continues to send these mixed messages. And for many people who are looking for a reliable power that they can stand with, China is not that. And what happened with Russia really shows how unreliable China can be, right? It continues to say the right things, but then when it comes to taking action, it stands back, right? And for many African countries, they're not looking for a power, a global power that is not really certain that it can guarantee them, because it takes a lot, right? The cost of challenging the US, the cost of challenging the EU for many African countries is quite huge. And if China is not willing to fill in that gap, then there is a big problem. And Zimbabwe is quite a good example of a country that pushed back and is paying a huge cost, right? Even though China has to some extent managed to assist them one way or the other, but the Zimbabwean government continues to seek re-engagement with the US, with the EU, because it doesn't see China as filling the gap that these countries have left. Perhaps the two other points that I want to make is that I like your argument that the characteristics of the regions shape China's behavior. Perhaps this is the strength that China has, that it can adapt to the needs of a particular region. And it has done quite well in sub-Saharan Africa, adapting to the needs of African countries and saying, okay, we want to work with you on what you want, right? Even in terms of the infrastructure projects, even in terms of many other things, China seemed to take a cue from what the African countries want and maybe support them to the extent that it wants to support them. So that really works quite well to the advantage of China and helps it to project this image that the West is a different actor. China seeks engagement through these different forums that you talked about, whereas the West seems to impose in some way. Even when they try to have forums like the US-Africa forum, they pick and choose who can come, right? And therefore, African leaders find China to be maybe receptive to their needs. Perhaps what could help, what may change things for China is that its Belt and Road Initiative, its infrastructure support to African countries in terms of providing financing and then actually helping in the construction of critical infrastructure that African countries want, there isn't really competition from the US and the EU. The Build Back Better, which was talked about 2 years, 3 years back, hasn't really come up with anything. The EU had its own initiative. Nothing really came out of that, right? Partly because they continue to put political conditions attached to it, economic conditions attached to it. And so China in this field of infrastructure development and financing, it doesn't have any competition in Africa. And so to the extent that it continues to provide that, African countries will to some extent continue to see China as, well, it's providing a service for now that we need. The last point that I want to make is that we can, to some extent, help China in its quest to engage sub-Saharan African countries is the, for lack of a better word, infantilization of African countries by the US particularly. That they continue to treat African countries as if they can't make a choice. It is the responsibility of the US, it is the responsibility of the EU, it is the responsibility of the UK to help African countries to decide what is good for them. And the pushback from many African countries, including South Africa, has been, we know who we want to engage with, we know what we want from each of these partners, and you don't have a right to tell us or to try to push us into a certain direction. And this is something that came up more recently, and perhaps along the lines that Yvonne was saying, that many developments have happened, which to some extent shaped some things. How the West can change its attitude in how it relates with African countries, perhaps may be the key. Yeah, so on that note, I think I'll end here, but thank you so much. I really enjoyed reading your book, and it's something that I can see recommending to my students and many people who are interested in understanding China's engagement with the Middle East and African countries. Thank you very much. I really appreciate this opportunity.
Great. Thanks so much, Obert. Don, before I go to the questions in the Q&A, I thought I'd give you maybe 10 minutes to pick and choose some of the questions and comments that Evan and Obert posed and let you try to tackle some of those. So maybe in the next 10 minutes.
Yes. Well, so first of all, thank you so much to both Evan and Obert for very insightful questions and asking many issues that I myself am continuing to look at, obviously, in my research. So Evan's first point regarding a lot has changed since the final version of this book came out, and mentioned a number of different factors, you know, whether it be Ukraine, the 20th Party Congress, deglobalization, souring Sino-American relations. I would add COVID to that mix. And so I do think in many ways, this is a fluid situation that in certain ways, I think COVID has put a lot on pause. And over the next year or two, we will start to see what the dynamic actually looks like. And I'm not going to have time to address all of these issues, but some of the broader shifts that I am seeing at this point would be one, that the Global South more broadly, and Middle East and Africa in particular, it appears is becoming more and more important to China from the standpoint of, as relations between the US and China are souring, and China is thinking through alternatives if you ultimately have a rupturing in the relationship between the PRC and the US, or China and Western Europe, et cetera, that these regions of the Global South more broadly would be very natural, both economic and political partners for China. And I mentioned this in my earlier remarks, but a lot of this order that China's building, I don't think in its origins, it was ever meant to replace the current order. I think it was meant to complement the order, but also to provide a backup plan if the order more broadly started to unravel. And there's lots of fraying of the system in general. But I will try to touch on those broader shifts as I get into the specific answers of some of Evan and Obert's other questions. So China's achieving its objectives, right? And Evan, you brought up a lot of examples regarding the special envoys, et cetera. And I think, so A, I have not yet, and it would be, you know, an amazing undertaking to try to really evaluate all of the foreign policy tools I look in the degree to which objectives are being met. But if, this is where it gets, I think, really complicated from the standpoint of looking at the Middle East issues envoy, right? China has an interest in that conflict being resolved because it sees it as a core of potential conflict in the region broadly. But I don't think when it established the special envoy, it really saw that it was going to be the actor that solved it, right? Setting up the envoy was more to demonstrate to countries in the region that it cared about issues that were important to them. And, you know, on other issues associated with economic objectives, et cetera, when you're looking very long-term, I do think, you know, arguably when you look at China's economic presence and the types of cooperation that China's now engaged in with both of these regions across functional areas, that if its objective is to have access to resources and markets and to have support from countries in these regions, increasingly it is achieving that part of the objective. But I think often it's not the very specific aspects of, you know, resolving Darfur or the Arab-Israeli conflict that it's aiming towards. It's more demonstrating support for those issues that matter to countries in the region. On the military diplomacy side, Evan raised some excellent points, especially regarding Saudi and the Emirates. And this is a fluid space. And I should note, in October, early November, I actually went over to Saudi and UAE. I'm doing research for my next book project, which is going to touch on a lot of the issues that Evan was describing, right? I think these are really important dynamics. But even though China's military, whether it be sales, you know, as you said, on drones, missile technology, et cetera, although that's increasing, I think countries in the Middle East in particular still see China very much as an economic and political actor, right? And potentially on the security front, more in being a balanced actor between states. And potentially, you know, for example, from a Saudi or Emirati perspective, that China may have a bit more sway with Iran than the US does, for example, right? So I think they see that broadly. But I didn't see, and I have not yet seen in my research, a real appetite for Arab states wanting to rely on China to provide the type of security guarantees or the type of security relationship that the US currently does. And I also don't think China has, you know, when you look at it in a very detailed way at the various documents that are generated and what's occurring, I don't think they're moving to that space either. So I do think you continue to have this bifurcation of China being seen as an economic and political actor and the US being seen as a security actor. But that starts to interact with some of the broader dynamics that you were mentioning, as far as there's also this perception of the US leaving the region, you know, whether that's because of more of an emphasis on Asia, whether it's, you know, other factors, but this increasing perception that the US is not there as much and that countries may not be able to rely on the US, as well as, you know, you mentioned many countries in these regions often are subject to criticism from the US that can vary across administrations. So again, I haven't published my findings from the research I did this, you know, in the fall, et cetera. But one interesting, you know, piece of feedback that I was getting more and more is this perception in the Arab Gulf in particular, that there's such swings between administrations in the US system for all of the reasons that we are familiar with. We're a democracy, we have a change administration, right? But they see these swings, and that China, given its political system and its leadership, there's a lot more continuity, and China, you know, being an enduring power in that way, but not a desire for China to provide for their security. I don't think there's this unrealistic expectation, but I think countries in the region increasingly are feeling pressure to choose sides potentially. And so they're reflecting on when China is their top economic partner and shares many of their values in the international system around sovereignty, et cetera. So I think they're thinking through those issues. I want to say a quick word about the meetings that occurred in December that Evan mentioned. There's three important elements to that. There was the bilateral between Xi and Mohammed bin Salman, right? There, so the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia bilat. There also was the China Arab States Cooperation Forum meeting. And then there was the China GCC meeting. So three distinct activities. So the bilateral, yeah, as you said, relations between China and the kingdom are positive, and it's an important country in the region. But I really perceived the visit in a much broader historical context from the standpoint of the China Arab States Cooperation Forum meets every 2 years. It was scheduled to meet this year in Beijing due to zero COVID circumstances. Beijing was not going to be an option, so they shifted it to Saudi Arabia. But when you look at the documents, when you look at the behavior, et cetera, other than being held at the summit level, which brings in leaders of the countries rather than just the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, it was a higher level, but all of the issues that were emphasized are issues that have been for quite a while. So you brought up this much broader, you know, set of foreign policy tools that are being looked at on energy and digital cooperation, health cooperation and AI and all of that. And when you look at the documents going back, that's been an emphasis of these forums for quite a while. I think it just received a lot more attention this year because everybody was looking at it closely. The GCC, having a GCC China summit in the way that they did, that was new. And that is an interesting development. And I do think broadly, all of this speaks to, compared to sub-Saharan Africa, increasingly, I do think the Middle East and the Arab Gulf in particular is becoming important to China for a number of reasons. And so you're seeing this shifting. But if you look at the beginning of this year, the Chinese Minister of Foreign Affairs, his first trip was to Africa, was to sub-Saharan Africa, and was demonstrating a renewed emphasis there. So I think it's going to be a while before we see, once we come out of COVID, what the emphasis really is between the different regions. And I only have 2 minutes left, so I'm not going to be able, obviously, to address all of the, you guys just brought up so many amazing issues. I wish we had days and days and days to talk about this. On the comparison between the regions, I think one of the main differences, and Obert, you brought this up in your comments. I do think China sees countries in the Middle East as more equal partners. Not that they frame it in this way, but they see those states as not reliant on aid, as, you know, major countries in the international system in various ways, where many sub-Saharan African countries, I do think they still focus on the development aspects and see more of an asymmetric relationship. That said, you know, you were making the comment regarding sub-Saharan Africa not, you know, in the international system, how much does sub-Saharan Africa matter to China being able to kind of shape the broader international environment? I wouldn't say sub-Saharan Africa in isolation matters that much from the standpoint of, if you think about regions around the world that are important to China and important to the US, sub-Saharan Africa still falls pretty low on both of those lists. But if you take sub-Saharan Africa and the Arab states and the broader Middle East and Latin America, to Evan's, you know, point, et cetera, I think that block, in general, if China is attempting to have influence compared to the West and the US, I think that block together is quite important. And again, we only have 20 minutes left. I'm so sorry. I want to talk a lot more about the broader comments, but I want to make sure we give the audience an opportunity to ask some questions as well.
Thanks, Dawn. Let me read the questions and maybe ask one of my own, and then I'll let Don and also Evan and Obert have a final word. So from Hilton Root, we have a comment and a question. Unfortunately, the Western powers, for the most part, have not treated African countries and most of the developing world as significant partners, as you just said. A case in point is DRC, where France and Belgium and allies exploited resources without even pretending to care about local infrastructure. The biggest contribution that Western powers brought was sponsorship of conflicts and coups, the case of Patrice Lumumba. Do you think the West, before China's rise, was interested in bringing African countries to the table? What do you think of China infrastructure investment in Kenya and other countries, and how has it improved access to the market? So two separate questions there. From Leslie Gaines, I look forward to reading your book. It seems that Chinese foreign policy and development reaches very far and will extend to Europe. Do you think that the alliance with Russia lately will be that entry? Also, the US has continuously underdeveloped its populace and education economically and politically in 60 years plus, as well as undermined the development of the developing world. Is this new world order overdue, whether it be headed by China or Latin America or Africa? Is China truly becoming a new social superpower or equal partner with African countries and the Middle East? Will the US need to cede power and influence despite its military might, given the sheer number of world partners, population-wise, and political economic partners? From Cornelius Yumphy, in relation to aid and financial inflows, there's been more transparency in terms of disaggregating aid flows, ODA and OOF, to determine policy interests. How do you see this changing the landscape of recipient African states' policy and interests? And finally, from Charlotte Kell, could you expand on the barriers slash delays related to China slash GCC free trade agreement? So those were the questions from the audience. And I just had one question that I thought I would take my privilege as a moderator to ask is, given what's been what we've been seeing in China lately with kind of the protests internally, we've witnessed this historically in the past where internal problems sometimes have the Chinese government turn inward and away from foreign policy priorities. Do you think what seems to have started and continues to build in China will have an impact on its foreign policy priorities? Let me leave it at that. Don, go ahead and take another 10 minutes. And if you wanna revisit again, some of the questions that Evan and Obert had, and then I'll have Evan and Obert also have a few minutes to comment and respond. Thanks.
Okay. So in response to the viewer questions just now, as far as Africa not being a priority previously, this ties into the last comment that I made, that I would say definitely in a post-Cold War era, sub-Saharan Africa was not necessarily a priority. I do think increasingly as Sino-American competition is growing, sub-Saharan Africa and the rest of the developing world is being looked at more closely from a strategic standpoint by the US. I would say that I think China, during the same time frame, has put a lot more strategic emphasis on sub-Saharan Africa and the developing world than the US have broadly. Regarding Russia and, I mean, this all gets, there's not enough time to get into all of this, but I do think there's an interesting dynamic on the China-Russia relationship from the standpoint that obviously from a US perspective, and this is just my own view, not US government necessarily, but obviously there's a desire given Russia's aggression in Ukraine for countries in the global South to be supporting various criticism of Russia. And I do think you see a lack of that criticism in many cases, partially could because of Russian pressure, et cetera. But I think most of it tends to be that states in these regions have a real, heavy focus on sovereignty and non-intervention and non-interference. And they're voting in a way that even minus Russian or Chinese pressure that they would have voted anyway, right? So how much of it is these states, China or Russia, being successfully, impacting the narrative. So I think a lot of the Russia piece, there's really not a China aspect necessarily in Middle East and Africa. It tends to be much more, what were countries' relationship with Russia already? What are their interests regarding sovereignty, et cetera? On aid and aid flows, this has come up a few times in kind of the questions in various ways. I would say in a pre-COVID environment and now in a post-COVID environment, China is trying to respond to criticisms that were already coming in regarding lack of sustainability, the types of aid they were providing, their own internal concerns about the outflow of foreign direct investment more broadly, et cetera. So you saw pre-COVID, I think, a more careful structuring of these deals. And now post-COVID, I think you, because of China's own internal challenges that you and that you talked about and that we're all aware of on slowing economic growth, et cetera, you may see less of a robust aid presence or economic presence in the short term associated with that. So I do think we see shifts there. On China GCC free trade agreement, I'd say the major impediments were previously when you had lack of unity in the GCC in a post-Arab awakening environment, that was keeping the FTA, so the GCC couldn't agree on what they wanted from China. Now they've become more unified, and I think it is more about market access and about states in the GCC feeling that the deal that China's providing does not adequately meet their needs. So you're having delays. You keep hearing it's going to be signed and then it isn't, et cetera. So I think now it's more about what the GCC wants and holding out for that in the longer term. And on, that's what I'll say on that. And I want to make sure others have a chance to comment as well. So Evan and Obert.
So I don't really have any, you know, particular or specific comments to make. I do think that it's important when we look at China's relationship with the developing world, not to look at it exclusively through the lens of U.S.-China competition. I don't think everything that China is doing with the Middle East and Africa is with a grand plan toward balancing U.S. power, right? I mean, as Dawn, as you pointed out in this presentation and in the book, China's relations with, Africa goes, you know, back decades, well into the 1960s. The relationship with the Middle East is obviously newer. But I do think that because of changes going on in the world today, and in particular, you know, at the Party Congress, one of the most striking aspects of the results of the 20th Party Congress was in the work report, Xi Jinping's assessment of the external environment was basically as dark an assessment as I've ever read in any work report. I mean, they no longer reference peace and development as the main trend of the times. They talk about turbulence and change, you know, threats of coercion, blackmail, et cetera, at any particular time. I mean, it was a very, very competitive view. And as a result, you know, Xi Jinping highlights in the work report, the view that it's going to be really important to emphasize. I mean, he sort of said this before, but he talks about, quote, embracing the fighting spirit and being prepared to struggle, right? And so, what I do wonder is the extent to which there's a new layer or an added layer to China's outreach to Africa and the Middle East, where China's really looking at it even more through the lens of U.S.-China competition. So the reason I say this is because, you know, given South Africa's recent announcement that they're going to conduct a joint naval drill with Russia and China, right? I mean, it raises certain questions. Why is South Africa doing this? Why are they doing it now? Who asked for it, right? But I mean, nonetheless, it's a pretty stark symbol of the direction of, travel of China's, approach, to these different regions, right? And, you know, I think we're going to see more security cooperation with the Middle East. It's pretty clear we're on that particular trajectory. Though I think that may have more to do with what you said, Dawn, which is just growing lack of confidence in the United States, looking for alternatives. But what I see is we may be entering an era where there is a unique convergence between basically what the region wants and what, or what these regions may want. I mean, as diverse as they are, but or what the major powers in these regions may want, and what the Chinese are offering and how the Chinese want to interact with them. I mean, for example, so with Africa, the new Chinese foreign minister did what he does every year, at the beginning of every year, right? He does a tour of Africa. And I believe that among the, he visited five or six countries, but in Africa, both sub-Saharan and Northern Africa. And two of the countries he visited was Benin and Gabon. And I believe, you know, if you look at China's trade relations with Benin and Gabon, they're not really very substantial. But I believe that Benin and Gabon are both currently rotating members of the UN Security Council, right? So that may explain why the Chinese. So, you know, while I think it's important, you know, as scholars to understand the diversity of interests at stake, and there's, you know, a push-pull dynamic between what the Chinese want and what the region's willing to give China. And I thought Obert was very articulate on this point about the diversity of views in sub-Saharan Africa, you know, the concern about Chinese influence. But nonetheless, given, you know, the rise of deglobalization, you know, the rise of great power competition, concerns about American staying power, et cetera, you know, I do think that you know, I do worry that sort of the developing world is, you know, and in particular, the regions we're talking about today are sort of becoming highly contested zones in this era of great power competition. So let me just stop there, and I'd love to hear Obert's thought.
All right, thank you very much. And let me pick up from where even you left off. The issue, I think, is what do regions like Africa and the Middle East want? Perhaps what does Africa want, and how does it see itself in this struggle or competition between the US and China? Is there any way that people talk about this US-China competition, and how do they define their role in this? I think competition between global powers over Africa is not a new thing. And Africa, to some extent, from the very existence of Africa, Berlin Conference and stuff like that, Africa has been, you know, something that is contested over. So it's not new for African countries that powers would fight over certain things in Africa. And perhaps that explains why you read newspapers in African countries, they don't talk about US-China competition and what their role is going to be in that competition. The issue is, and it also something that came up when the US was saying African countries need to pick a side, whether they're standing with Russia or they're standing with the US. And many African countries were like, why should we pick a side? It's your war, you're fighting it on your own. Why should we do that? The issue is African countries don't care so much about these struggles, because what they think is, first of all, they think we don't have a say in these issues. The second thing is, what platforms are there for African voices to be had? If it is not the UN General Assembly, where if you have noticed when African leaders are speaking, the room is almost empty. They're speaking to their own audiences, sometimes their own delegates, right? So they realize we don't have a voice. The AU is preoccupied with issues of development, preoccupied with issues of conflict that are coming up. And so it has only become most recently to start trying to have a unified voice on Africa's position and its relationship with China. But also at this time, this competition, to some extent, African countries look at it and say, now that they're fighting against each other or they're fighting over something, whatever that thing is, everyone is looking at Africa like, we want your support. So African leaders, the same African leaders who would attend if they're invited to the US-Africa summit, they will attend. If France has an Africa summit, they will attend. If Turkey has won, they will go. If China has won, they will go. If Russia has, they will go. It just shows that these leaders, they don't have any allegiance to any of these global powers. And all they're looking for are their own the domestic interests, what they want to save, whether they want their regime to be recognized or they want development assistance or whatever. So it's very limited to national interest. What does an African leader want at that particular point? Not necessarily placing themselves in these geostrategic issues and stuff like that. For many African leaders, they think this is not really that important for us. We have more important issues to deal with, and we would deal with whoever is willing to give them to us at the least cost. And at this point, China is giving Africa what it needs at the least cost. African leaders don't need to change much. So I think when the US and the Western media is talking about its struggles with Russia, with China, for many African voices, they are not really there because they don't see what role they could play. And that brings back then the issue that Dawn talked about in her book, which I really like so much, how this indifference of African leaders to this global competition or this competition between the US and China, shaping how China and the US look at African countries. I think that could be very interesting to think. Let me end there.
Thanks, Obert. Dawn, last 2 minutes for you.
Okay. So I want to build a little bit on Evan's comments regarding Sino-American competition and the way that that's kind of, that dynamic is shifting. One thing I didn't talk about, but one of the major differences that I saw while I was writing the book was that although most of the foreign policy tools and engagement between the Middle East and Africa were almost exactly the same, other than the focus on foreign aid and sub-Saharan Africa, you know, and a bit more equal approach to Middle East, very same, but China in sub-Saharan Africa and through FOCAC wanted to publicize this activity. It did not see it as a US sphere of influence and felt much more comfortable with taking credit for and emphasizing and really trying to get as much PR as it could out of that. In the Middle East, it was much more cautious. You know, you think about even the documents coming out from these meetings, they come out in Chinese and Arabic for very practical reasons, right? But they're not publishing it in English. They weren't wanting it to be really public facing. They would be very quiet. So I think what we've seen over the last several years has been a shift in some of that in actually looking at the behavior. So if you look at the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, admitting Iran as a formal member and now looking at Turkey as, you know, going to include them, and then ultimately the dialogue partners, you know, that's starting to move into Middle East in a way that previously was not occurring. And the UAE base that I think Evan had mentioned, some of the speculation regarding that, you know, it's media reports, it's in the open source, et cetera, that if overtures like that are being made, that would be a change. So if you think about when China established Djibouti, a big part of why they put it in Djibouti was it wouldn't be seen to be impeding on the US sphere of influence in various ways. They're being very cautious about Arab states and having something there, both with the US and more broadly. And then you look even at this last meeting in December with Xi Jinping going to Saudi. This was, I think, very natural, but the fact that they chose to have it in such a high profile fashion, move it to the summit level, have it continue after Biden had just visited, and that the optics associated with that may not have been optimal. In the past, you would have probably seen more of a behavior of them delaying a bit or not wanting to be seen as confrontational in that way. And I think China is more willing to engage in behavior that could be perceived as competitive from the US more broadly. So I know we're at the end of our time, but I really appreciate both Evan and Obert. I agree with 99.9% of the comments you made. And I think this is just a really important area, and that as we go over the next 5 or 10 or 20 years, this is only gonna become more important to understand these issues, because previously it has been an understudied issue, although a number of people, including Evan and Obert, have written on these issues. There's a lot more work to be done.
Thank you all so much. Thank you to our audience for being with us. Thank you, Don, Ober, and Evan for joining us this morning. The next event of the Africa-China Initiative will be held in person and over Zoom, and will focus on China-Africa media and cultural engagements. More information on that will come shortly, but we hope that you'll be able to join us on Friday, the 24th of February, in the morning from 9 to 12:30. Again, thank you so much for joining us today, and we look forward to seeing you again next month.